How's everybody doing? I'm Jay Elsen, and this is a brand new year of Kyle Corner. Well, following their pre-Christmas sweep of Montana State and Montana, Craig Smith and the Coyotes had a chance to close 2014 on a high note. The opportunity came Sunday, December 28th, as they went for a third straight win against defending Horizon League tournament champion Wisconsin-Milwaukee.
The Panthers would get the first bucket of the afternoon, but that would be the first and only time USD would trail all day. Tyler Larson backing down Steve McWhorter. Advantage Larson. Larson scored 22 on the day. Yotes up 10 at the break. But that wasn't enough for this man. Casey Kasperbauer was dialed in. USD's junior sniper matches his career high with 7 threes, including a 6-for-6 mark in the second half. He led all scorers with 23. Kasperbauer was the story outside, but inside it was all about James Hunter. The Aussie rattles the rim here, but he ups the ante moments later, showing some springs as he drops the hammer. Hunter put up a career-best 15 points on 7 of 10 shooting, and the Coyotes roll over Milwaukee by a count of 84-60. Things got much more important on Friday as the Coyotes open the Summit League slate against Omaha. USD catches fire late in the first. Coyotes hit threes on 4 straight possessions, 3 of them coming from Casey Kasperbauer. USD 8 of 13 beyond the arc in the half as a team. And they led 41-29 at the break. The lead still 12 with about 12 and a half minutes to play, but that's when CJ Carter took over. Inside, outside, didn't matter. The senior scored 8 straight to tie the game at 55. Carter led all scorers with 24. Coyotes down 3 a few minutes later. Larson back and forth with Brandon Boss. Lay-in cuts the deficit to 1. Next possession, Larson does it himself, follows his shot, gets the putback and 1. 3-point play puts USD back in front, 71-70. But that would be the Coyotes' last lead of the night. The Summit League's highest scoring team poured in 43 points over the final 12-plus minutes, and they go on to snap USD's 3-game winning streak, 86-77. Coyotes had to put that one behind them in a hurry because they were back on the floor 2 days later in Denver looking to avoid the dreaded 0-2 start. Things not looking real good early in the second half, though. Cam Griffin, nice look to Marcus Byrd for the and-one. Byrd had 13. Last year's Coyote killer doing his thing, too. Brett Olson splashes the 3, helping the Pioneers stretch the lead to 11. That's when things started to click for the Coyotes. Off the block, Larson with the bump and the bucket. First of 5 straight points for the senior. Kasperbauer picked it up from there. This for the lead. 48-46 USD. 2 minutes later, still raining. NBA range this time, all part of a 28-4 Coyote run. Kasperbauer still not done. Drains his 4th tray of the half to make it 67-55 Coyotes with 3.5 to play. Kasperbauer finished with 15. The Pioneers not done. They hitch their wagon to the Summit League's preseason player of the year, and Olson almost brought them back. He scored 7 of his game-high 24 points in the final 2.5 minutes, but it wasn't enough. South Dakota holds off Denver to pick up its first Summit League victory, 74-69. Larson led the way with 22, and how about James Hunter? The Aussie continues his recent surge with 12 points on 5 of 7 shooting. That was a huge bounce-back win for USD, and even more valuable because it came on the road. We'll have more on that with head coach Craig Smith right after this.
Coyote Corner on Midco Sports Network is presented by BillionAuto.com.
Hey, welcome back. We are joined now by head coach of the USD men, Craig Smith. And Craig, the Summit League season is upon us. Conference play got underway this last weekend. You guys, of course, all the way back to last week, wrapped up the 2014 portion of your schedule with an impressive win over UW-Milwaukee to kind of set you off on the right foot as Omaha came to town for that conference opener on Friday night. This game, really a tale of two halves, though. You guys started strong, got off to that 10-2 run, closed the half strong as well, went into the break up 12.
Yeah, you know, Omaha is a very good team. They're electric in transition. We knew we had to do a great job controlling tempo, which we felt like we did in the first half. I thought we took great shots. We were up by 12, felt like we should have been up by maybe even 18 to 20 going into halftime. And it was a tale of the two halves as the second half went south in a hurry.
All of a sudden, the tide started to change a little bit, and C.J. Carter had a lot to do with that. I mean, you guys were up 55-43, so 12,
yep,
with 12 and a half to play, and that's when Carter really got going. He's a difference maker, no question about it, and he showed why on Friday.
Yeah, he's as good of an athlete as you're going to find, and he's like the microwave, like back in the day. He can put up points in a hurry, and he was responsible for a 12-0 run by himself. It was the first time all year that I really felt like we kind of got a little panicky. You know, we had control of the game, they start making a run, and we kind of just had this kind of this blank look in our eyes, you know. And but it's a great lesson for us. We'll learn from it. At the end of the day, we allowed them 43 points in the first 28 minutes of the game. But in the last 12 minutes of the game, they scored 43 points, and you're just not going to give up. You're not going to win many games when you're allowing 57 points in the second half.
Now, it ends with an 86-77 loss, maybe tougher to swallow still because five of the next six then were going to be on the road. And you said afterwards you were going to learn a little bit about your team. Well, you got a chance on Sunday at Denver. Very tough place to play. The Pioneers beat USD all three times they've played them last year. And this one was, again, a tale of two halves, but this time it kind of swung in your favor.
Yeah, it really was. It was almost a carbon copy of the Omaha game, except, you know, flipping the script, so to speak. And you know, we got off to a great start in the game, up 10-2. James Hunter went 4-for-5 early in the game, really sparked us. And then we kind of got tentative, and that's what Denver does. They get you standing around in their matchup zone. They make you defend for 30, 35 seconds, and they just prey off of your mistakes. We had to go zone early, and then we didn't start off the second half well. After that first media, we got on our guys pretty good and challenged them in a big-time way. And they responded with a 28-4 run, which is hard to do in any game, and it's even more difficult to do against a team that plays the style of play that Denver does. It is incredibly difficult to win in that place and to go against that style and the way we defend that. But I thought our guys showed a lot of poise, a lot of resiliency. When we ripped them on them in that timeout, Tyler Larson stepped up and said, "Guys, let's just all take a deep breath." And I said, maybe that's our problem. We're all taking too big of deep breaths. You know, let's just show some aggressiveness. But at the same time, it was great for Tyler to step up and understand, you know, what was at stake and trying to calm some of the guys that were maybe a little jittery or tentative or whatever it might be. And we responded very, very well. Made our free throws late, executed late. We missed a couple easy chip shots, you know, that would have sealed the deal. But we didn't turn it over late, and we made our free throws.
74-69 the final, even your record in the Summit League at 1-1. The road trip continues this weekend. But if anything, the opening weekend of league play showed us is that this thing is wide open. Fort Wayne, the preseason favorite, 0-2, and that's where you guys are on Saturday.
Yeah, the Summit League, I mean, the only thing predictable is it's going to be unpredictable. And it's going to be a fun year. There's going to be so many close games. We've been working on late game situations for a long time because we're not really built to just go out and, you know, annihilate somebody. And so there's going to be a lot of great games in conference. I'm not sure that anybody's head and shoulders above anybody. And so it should be an enjoyable ride for all the fans.
All right, great stuff. Congrats on the win on Sunday, Craig, and good luck to you this week.
Thank you, Jay.
All right, thanks a lot. Well, the USD women also tipped off Summit League play this last weekend against Omaha. We'll have highlights from that one when we come back.
Coyote Corner on Midco Sports Network is presented by BillionAuto.com.
The USD women made the most of their recent homestand, capping a perfect five-game run with a thrilling win over North Dakota just before Christmas. Amy Williams' team looked to continue its winning ways a few days later in San Antonio with a pair of games at the UTSA Holiday Classic. Things got off to a decent start as the Coyotes topped the host team 76-69. For their eighth straight victory, all five starters finished in double figures for USD, led by Nicole Seacamp and Margaret McLeod with 16 apiece. South Dakota shot nearly 51% for the game compared to 34% for the Roadrunners. Rebounding was the only reason this game was close at all. The Coyotes, one of the best in the Summit League in that department, surrendered 22 offensive boards, which led to 23 second-chance points for UTSA. USD back in action one day later against Chattanooga, and the Mocs, who came in ranked fourth in the mid-major poll, put an end to the Coyotes' winning streak. 67-54, the final. It was a rough day offensively as USD failed to make a three-pointer for the first time this season, finishing 0-for-6 from outside. Coyotes also turned it over a season high 24 times. Not exactly the way the Coyotes were hoping to end one of the more exciting calendar years in USD women's basketball, but the new year offered a new beginning with the start of the Summit League season in Omaha. Coyotes hoping to get the offense back on track in their matchup with the Mavericks, but it wasn't there early on. Nicole Seacamp connects for three, but that was the only triple of the first half. Coyotes were 1-for-13 from outside. The shots weren't falling, but USD did a good job of cleaning up the mess. Margaret McLeod gets the putback. Coyotes finished with 18 second-chance points. UNO kept the pace thanks in large part to Remy Davenport, the freshman. 4-for-5 from downtown in the first half, helping the Mavs open up a three-point lead. Yotes get back on top before the break, though. McLeod off a great feed from Seacamp. The Rapid City native notched 11 points and 10 rebounds. Later, Seacamp does it herself. Coyotes led 27-25 at the half. They started to pull away in the second. Rachelle Contreras from way outside. That really got the ball rolling. Seacamp on the break, plus the foul. She had 11, and the lead is 6. Coyotes led by as many as 19 in the second half, and they go on to win for the ninth time in 10 games, 64-48, and improved to 11-3 overall, and 1-0 in the Summit League. Well, it may not have been pretty, but a win is a win. Find out what Amy Williams had to say about it next.
Coyote Corner on Midco Sports Network is presented by BillionAuto.com.
And welcome back to Coyote Corner. Jay Elsen joined down here in Vermilion by head coach of the USD Women, Amy Williams. And Amy, obviously back to basketball, back to business as usual for you as you get past the holidays and get into really the meat of your schedule with the conference season. But let's start with the week that was for the USD Women, and it got going on the road, which is appropriate for right now for you because you're going to be spending a lot of time on the road. But you played a couple of games down at the UTSA, Texas San Antonio Holiday Classic. It opened up against the host team from Texas San Antonio on December 28th, and you carried with you a 7-game winning streak, and you extended that to 8 with a win over the Roadrunners 76-69. And in that game for you, great balance offensively, which is something that your team has shown all year. All 5 starters in double figures, and Nicole Seacamp and Margaret McLeod led the way with 16 each.
Yeah, I mean, I was really very pleased with our offensive performance in that ball game, and I thought we shared the ball well, and Margaret really established herself inside and brought a great presence for us in the paint, and so that was the positive end of things. Mm-hmm. We were a little disappointed with some of the other aspects of our game in that game, just a little rusty defensively, and most importantly, on the rebounding side of things, we were kind of disappointed in that ball game. I thought UTSA and their athleticism really kind of exposed some things for us, and we gave up 22 offensive rebounds, which is very uncharacteristic for our team, and right. It led to 23 second chance points, which I really think kept it a ball game and kind of was the reason we had to kind of scratch and claw to pull that win out, and certainly feel like if we would have taken care of business on the boards like we normally do, that could have been a much easier win for us.
At the end of the day, maybe not satisfied with how it happened, but pleased with the fact that you get the win, and that was your 8th straight overall at that point. Well, the next day, though, you came in a different kind of challenge because you faced a Chattanooga team that came in ranked number 4 in the country in the latest mid-major poll at the time. And they get you 67-54 to end that winning streak. This was a tough team and a good measuring stick, though, for your team.
Yeah, I mean, we were really excited about the opportunity to kind of just see where we were at and use that game as a measuring stick. And I don't think that anybody in our program was pleased with kind of the way that we handled that test. And we certainly were playing against a great team. And I give a lot of credit to Chattanooga. They find ways to just really make things difficult for you on the offensive end of the floor. And they certainly did that. And our team usually is – is a pretty high scoring team, and to hold us to 54 points, we just couldn't even really get open shots available. But the biggest disappointment in that game was just uncharacteristic turnovers for our team, and 24 turnovers is just, you know, about two games worth of turnovers for our team. So that's certainly something that we need to kind of clean up moving forward.
And from that point, you moved forward into the Summit League and the conference season. And obviously, this is the most important part of your regular season. You open up Friday night at Omaha. You get a 64-48 win, but the offensive struggles that we saw against Chattanooga sort of continued, at least in the first half of this one.
It's sometimes easy to kind of fall into kind of a slump of standing around when you're playing against a zone defense, and I thought we did that a little bit in the first half, and we're ending up having to take shots that were not kind of characteristic out of the flow of our offense, and we didn't shoot the ball particularly well in that half. But in the second half, I think we came out and really moved the basketball and moved a lot more sharper and just kind of attacked their zone a little bit better, and we're able to kind of get back to Coyote basketball in the second half and really play the way we feel like we can offensively.
The road trip, though, continues this week with a pair of games away, first on Thursday night at Oral Roberts, and then you head to Macomb, Illinois for a rematch with Western Illinois, first time you've seen them since last year's Summit League quarterfinals.
Yeah, I mean, it just doesn't get any easier from here. And on the road, just kind of a unique challenge heading down to Oral Roberts this week, as we'll, you know, be playing, you know, a team that we're not as familiar with, mm-hmm. because they've been out of the Summit League for a little while. But, you know, also they have a 6'7" post player inside. Oh. So, you know, kind of a unique challenge to face somebody like that. And then to turn around and get to play Ashley Luke and the crew down at Western Illinois, who's just, they've been playing spectacular and throwing lots of points on the board as well. So it's going to be two tough road games, and you know, it's a good challenge for us.
Looking forward to seeing it, and good luck to you this weekend. We'll see you back here next week.
Sounds good, Jay.
All right, thanks, Amy. Well, Casey Kasperbauer has a chance to go down as one of the top three-point shooters in USD history. We'll have more on the Coyotes sharpshooter when we come back.
Coyote Corner on Midco Sports Network is presented by Billionauto.com.
And welcome back. Well, the South Dakota men's basketball program has seen its share of change in the past three seasons. One constant has been the shooting touch of guard Casey Kasperbauer. Alex Heinert has more on what makes the junior one of the best marksmen in the Summit League.
What makes someone a great shooter? Is it talents? Good coaching? Most would say it takes hours upon hours and years upon years of practice. Time that South Dakota's Casey Kasperbauer has more than put in.
In the off season, it can be anywhere from 1 to maybe 3 hours a day if we're bored that day. After I'm done talking to you here, I'll probably get some shots up because I got nothing else to do today.
The gym time the junior shooting guard put in growing up led to a stellar prep career at Carroll High School in Iowa and earned him a scholarship to USD, where he's been a key contributor in each of his first three seasons. Through no fault of his own, though, his time in Vermilion hasn't been without trials, as each offseason of his Coyote career has seen a new head coach take over the program.
This adjustment comes in the summer when you don't really know what offense we're going to run and you don't really know what the defense philosophy is of that coach, but day by day you get a better feel for what that coach wants and needs out of you, both as a team and as individuals. So it was a big adjustment, but it's worked out really well so far.
Things have worked out this season, as under new head coach Craig Smith, Kasperbauer has stepped back into the starting role he became familiar with his freshman year. Smith knew he might have found something in the junior only hours after taking the job.
Well, first thing, when I met with the team, he stood out because he looks you dead in the eye. I mean, he's got a presence to him. He's got a great manner. He's got great mannerisms to him, but you can feel him. He's got a presence. And so he's locked in. I mean, he is locked and loaded all the time.
Kasperbauer's intelligence and hard work have served to make him one of the Summit League's best three-point threats since 2012. On two occasions already this season, Kasperbauer has hit 7 threes in a game, with the second occurring after Christmas in the Yotes 84-60 win over Milwaukee.
You hear a lot of shooters talk about how the rim gets bigger and bigger the more they go in, and the good shooting games that I've had, I've noticed that for sure.
If you drive and kick the Casey, he's going to make 8 out of 10. And I always say 8 out of 10 on purpose. And he'll always say, Coach, 9 out of 10. You know, and you love that about the kid.
With the conference season now underway, Smith and company have confidence that Kasperbauer will keep the three-pointers and the Coyote wins coming thick and fast.
He's as good a shooter as I've coached in my 19 years. He's one of those guys that when he gets an open shot, the coaching staff, every player stands up, every fan stands up, because they feel like as soon as it leaves his hand, it's going in. And what I love about that is Casey believes that as well. Shooters got to believe they're always going to make the next shot, and he truly believes that.
And with the shots falling like they are this year, why wouldn't you believe?
You just develop a rhythm out there, and there's not a good way to describe that feeling, but it feels awesome.
The Coyotes would love to see Kasperbauer's hot shooting continue this weekend in Fort Wayne. The Summit League's preseason favorites off to a surprising 0-2 start in conference play after losses to Western Illinois and IUPUI over the weekend. USD comes in 7-9 overall, 1-1 in the league, but they are also 0-3 all-time in Fort Wayne. Should be a good one Saturday night. Tip-off scheduled for 6 p.m. Central Time at the Gates Sports Center. The women are also back on the road starting Thursday night at Oral Roberts. This will be the first meeting between the teams since 2011. The Golden Eagles are 0-2 in the league after losses at NDSU and Denver. Then it's on to Western Illinois for a date with preseason player of the year Ashley Luke and the Leathernecks. The Coyotes 3-0 all-time in Macomb. This one slated for 4:30 Saturday afternoon. And we'll have highlights from all three of those games next Tuesday night for you on another episode of Coyote Corner. Until then, I'm Jay Elsen. Thanks for watching.